A procession of clowns. It is Orlando's memory. Orlando sits under an oak tree. He has a Colombian red-tailed boa constrictor for the entirety of the play. Sometimes he carries her in a pillowcase.
There is an oak tree under which I sit with my snake, Orlando. I am writing a poem about said oak tree and said snake. It's very meta. If you are a Moor, I will chop off your head and kill you dead, even though I'm part Moor. Not in a violent way. They're just children's dreams. I am bored already.
A trumpet and much fanfare, a pageant. It is Queen Elizabeth.
Who are you?
Orlando.
Why are you in our way?
I'm sitting here.
We are walking.
That's impressive.
You are a plebeian.
You are the queen.
Elizabeth.
You are beautiful.
We thank you.
I didn't vote for you.
What does that mean? Vote. Are you going to move?
I cannot.
We can have you killed.
I wouldn't mind.
You are a Christian.
I don't believe.
God is all around us.
You are the sinner.
How old are you?
13.
Where are your parents?
They left me.
Under this spruce tree?
It's an oak.
We are afraid you're mistaken.
This is an acorn.
We don't recognize nuts.
And a snake.
That is against the law.
It is not.
Religious law.
There is no such thing.
At the least, it is profane.
Her name is Orlando.
Snakes are male. Orlando is a male name.
You can't tell with snakes until they're two. They grow these reproductive
this
scales.
This does not interest us.
She eats live rats.
We need fewer rats. However, if that is supposed to court us...
Do you like poetry?
If it sustains itself.
There is an oak tree.
We are bored already.
You really are very beautiful.
We thank you. You are too young.
It's 1592.
When you finish your poem, come to Windsor.
It's a very wide poem.
We shall wait.
A flourish. Malcolm, a beefeater, opens the door.
Your name?
Orlando.
What is the purpose of your visit?
I wrote a poem.
A poem?
For the Queen.
You wrote a poem for the Queen?
Yes, she knows I am coming.
The Queen is not here.
Who's at the door, Malcolm?
The Queen is indeed here.
Tell her it's Orlando.
Let him in, Malcolm. He's a man.
I'm 20, sir.
He wrote us a poem.
You may enter. There are certain things you mustn't touch nor speak of.
Oh, shut it, Malcolm.
Malcolm the beefeater exits with a look.
That took long enough.
I told you I would bring it.
Is it written by hand?
It's bound and printed.
Sign it, in my presence.
It's already inscribed.
She inspects it ruefully.
Wine?
Thank you.
Food?
What is it?
Moroccan. You eat it with your fingers. There are spices. You must lick them.
It tastes sweet.
It's pomegranate.
You have a wonderful life.
And saffron. I never tasted it before.
You said I.
So we did.
I never had anything.
Having is irrelevant.
Have you had a person?
As we said, I've killed many people. That was much better than expected. Where are you from?
Under the oak tree.
Before that?
I don't have a place.
We will be lovers. There is war brewing with Ireland.
In bed.
Good morning.
Oh.
The sun is billowing through the curtains.
I didn't...
Didn't what?
I didn't know.
I love you.
It's untenable.
We can have an heir.
I met a Norwegian princess.
We are a queen.
Silence. Birds.
Who are her parents?
I sat upon her leg.
Is she well bred?
Yes. I told her I would see you. She sends her regards.
Well, we believe that's all that needs to be said.
She smashes a mirror.
I am sleeping with a lot of women. It's becoming a problem. Sally's the one I love, but she doesn't love me. Anka, Princess of Norway, died of gout. I am presently sleeping with Nora, Helen, Mary, and Nell, and sometimes Sally. They're all poor. I need to manage my time. Nell is getting anxious. I also met a Portuguese Moor. He is now a dear friend. Sometimes we sleep together. I am confused. Orlando takes up most of my time. I satisfy women in the moment, but snakes take such less care. I am addicted to Moroccan spices.
Scene 5. Orlando enters a country pub.
You're not from here?
That is correct.
You have a name?
Orlando.
How much money do you have?
A few shillings.
We only accept shillings.
Shillings.
Shall we sing a shilling song?
Who's he?
Orlando.
Where's he from?
Outside.
London.
He's having a drink.
Fine by me.
Who is this?
Orlando.
Where's he from?
London.
Why is he here?
He's having food.
A sausage and a potato.
That's right.
Shut it.
Who's this?
Orlando.
He looks queer to me.
He's paying for the food.
Oh my.
Who the hell is this?
Is this a goddamn comedy?
Obviously not.
His name is Orlando. He's eating food.
Your food?
Shut it.
Have you got the plague?
I don't think so.
Keep your distance.
Are there others?
We used to talk about simple things.
Here we go.
I don't remember those times.
They were.
They used to be.
Just shut it, all of you. Shut it. All this talk.
A pathetic flourish in procession. King James enters.
Hail King James!
Who are you?
Orlando!
You are in my way.
I'm sitting.
Who are these people?
Plebeians!
Oh, we've heard of them.
Would you like something, or are you just taking up space?
Who is this?
The pub keeper.
Have him killed.
The river is frozen.
There is a festival. The people should be pleased.
We are miserable.
So they say.
Pronouns will be our downfall.
You interest me.
I'm sleeping with Euphrosyne.
I didn't mean to suggest.
Are you at least going to have a drink?
Didn't we have you killed?
There is a tide.
In the affairs of men.
I love you, but it is not possible.
At least skate with me on the river.
I will do that.
They skate on ice.
I haven't done this since I was a child.
I've never.
You have the world. If anyone ever tells you that you cannot do something, ignore them. Life is the manifestation of your own dreams.
That's quaint.
Remember me.
Orlando and Tatiana dance on the ice. It is snowing.
You are an Aquarius.
How did you know?
I have eyes.
You are from Russia.
St. Petersburg.
Have I known you forever?
The Russian people are very old. We have culture. Britain is old also, but you have no culture.
I'm Irish.
I'm so sorry for you.
She examines his palm.
Your life will end, and you have a snake.
A boa constrictor. Her name is Orlando.
She is man.
Well, I didn't know whether she was male or female.
She is snake. What does it matter?
I love her.
That is strange.
Love does not know species. You can't convince me it does. Love is blind.
Tomorrow there will be a storm.
Who are you?
I am an artist and a seer.
May I marry you? Tomorrow?
It is possible.
I love you.
Tatiana sits on a sailor's lap.
What are you doing?
I'm sitting here.
Orlando is perplexed.
This is what people do. They sit. Do you really love me?
Yes.
Then I will stay with you. We will be married tomorrow.
They kiss. Tomorrow comes. Tatiana is gone. Orlando sinks into a deep depression.
I am in a state of mourning for my life. I wear only black. It is Chekhov play. I anticipate disasters. I bought a gun for the end. The blood runs upstream through cobblestone streets, up to the doorstep, into the kitchen. Love in the form of magical realism. I built a fortress, a home, really. It has 365 rooms and 52 staircases and 526 doors. Room 174 is the room. It brings you visions. There is a woman who lives in that room. She takes care of the entire property in my absence. She told me yesterday that I needed to go sit under the magnolia tree. We don't have a magnolia tree. She also told me that caterpillars were wiser than children, sound is quiet, and astronauts flew to the moon on three rusty tricycles. I like her, but she lies. She's confused. The word lie is profane now. We read, we write, we live our lives. We admire shiny objects and things that fly. Impossible things. There are 365 rooms and 52 staircases. Photographs of times past. There are 6 chandeliers, 13 pantries, and 447 closets. There is a room that belonged to my sister once. There's a service elevator with an imaginary butler. The best thing is that time is irrelevant. When we were younger, there were only 3 rooms and a screen door. A river that was 17 inches wide and 32 childhoods deep. There was a television with an antenna, a toaster, a jar of quarters, 3 beds, and a closet full of keys to the other rooms. There was Tupperware, Avon, and a pile of golf balls. There were four windows in the sky. Now, there are 365 rooms and 14 chimneys. One of them sticks out the side.
What are you writing?
The same goddamn poem.
The oak tree.
The bane of my existence.
Why don't you leave it?
I burned everything else. It's all I have left.
You're a decent writer.
There is an oak tree under...
I am bored already.
It's meant to be a metaphor.
Metaphors are for people who aren't doing anything. People who sit under oak trees and write.
I tend to snakes.
Now that is interesting. What are their names?
Orlando and Orlando.
How do they tell themselves apart?
They have snake brains.
How do you tell them apart?
One is male and one is female.
You are still writing.
I can't not.
You should just kill yourself. End the misery.
That's what all writers do.
Most. My primary school students believe the world is flat.
Really?
That's what they told me. I don't know what to believe anymore.
These are dangerous times.
I have a woman for you. The Archduchess Harriet of Romania. She is a fine breed.
We were in Prussia, and there was a woman on the street who reeked of garlic. Aroma. You couldn't get the stench of garlic off her. She smelled of poverty. She said to me in her accent, she said to me, "Are you living here?" And I said, "No." "Please help me," she said, like a Cretan. "Please help me. You have money, you travel. I have no food for my children, anything. Please, please, please." And she touched me. It was horrible.
I sometimes ask for help.
Yes, but she made it an entire ordeal. She was obviously poor. She didn't need to emphasize it.
Poverty is relative.
Of course, your perspective is your perspective. You have money.
I don't. I have people who give me things.
No money whatsoever?
£7 and a few shillings.
How do you live? I mean, how do you buy things?
I know people. And I don't need things.
If you don't have £500 in property, you don't really amount to anything, do you? I didn't have anything before we bought this house. It's been a godsend, property and the business.
I'm leaving England.
Oh. I am sending you to Persia as an ambassador. You are now a duke.
Orlando and Orlando the Snake dance. Orlando travels to Constantinople on a boat. The audience members are passengers. Orlando passes through a row of audience members. Sorry. Excuse me. She's friendly. He goes to another row and makes an audience member move. This is my seat. He has a ticket. He sits down with the snake. Don't worry, she's fine. Just don't move. Orlando meets Rosina Papita. She is a Spanish dancer.
You are not a man yet.
The French would disagree.
Did you storm the Bastille?
It stormed me.
You have good skin. Take off your clothes.
After we dance.
There is a tango, during which Rosina Papita takes off Orlando's clothes. She ties him up. They have sex. This ordeal astonishes Orlando and leaves him in a trance. He is unconscious on his bed, naked and half-tied. There is a war outside. Vigilantes enter and steal money and other things. Should we kill him, says one. Why waste the bullet, says the other. 7 days pass. Orlando awakens under the bed as a woman. It does not take her too much time to get used to her new body. She looks at her old self. She covers her old self with a blanket. She gets dressed. There is a knock at the door.
Who am I?
You are a woman.
Orlando, who are you?
Rustum. I'm a woman also.
I dreamt that you would come.
You are not safe here. I will bring you to the mountains.
They are in the mountains. The peasants watch and beg. It is a treacherous journey. Again, when they arrive, there is food and spice.
It is very kind of you.
I can tell you are a good person. Eat.
Orlando has never tasted food like this.
The tomatoes.
The soil is good.
And the peppers?
You must plant them near the rocks. It keeps the soil warm.
It's beautiful.
It is home.
Where do you sleep?
On the floor, in the corner.
Where does your husband sleep? And the children?
Ashraf sleeps next to me, and the children sleep outside.
Beneath the stars, hidden by the trees.
In the breeze. It is night.
I love this place. You should have a bed. I could help you build it. And a counter. Do you have meat?
The goats are for winter.
You should have a pond for ice skating.
You don't understand us.
We could cut down a tree.
Who is this?
I must return to England.
On the dock, there are sailors in general commotion. The ship is about to set sail.
Who is this?
Orlando.
That's a queer name.
Is this boat headed to London?
I'll take you to the moon.
You mean head.
Sorry, Nicholas.
Thank you.
They're preparing to set sail. They're dogs in heat.
London?
We go to Calais.
Then to London?
No. You must take a ferry, to another ferry, to a coach.
Are you the captain?
I'm the cook.
20 minutes, Captain.
Thank you, Jeremy. I'm sorry. I meant to say, yes, I am the captain. Jeremy is the cook and the doctor. He's good at cutting things. I steer. Who did you say you were?
Orlando.
Nicholas, were you implying you wanted to board?
I must return to England.
This is a merchant vessel.
I climb. I speak 5 languages. I used to be a man in another life.
All quarters are full.
I will sleep in a corner, sir.
Jeremy?
Aye, Captain.
Take Orlando's bags and put it in a cabin. She'll be stowing with us at least till Cyprus.
Aye, Captain. Hey, lads, you won't believe it.
I hope you know what you just got yourself into.
He helps her onto the boat, and they are on the deck in the middle of the ocean.
It's lovely.
It's the ocean.
The stars on the horizon.
How did you get to Constantinople in the first place?
I flew.
You are a dreamer.
There is an oak tree.
I'm bored already. I don't understand poetry. It's only words.
Oh, but it's so much more. It's saffron, the tango, love.
I was once in love.
What happened?
They broke my heart. It's complicated.
In my former life, I was in love with a Russian princess. She broke my heart as well. Are you always on the sea?
I have a home.
Where?
In Calais. I sail for half the year.
Do you have a wife?
Yes. And 2 daughters. We had a son, but he's dead and buried.
I would like a son.
Pirates!
What?
I'm sorry. Dinner! It's in your cabin. Pirates are tomorrow.
Your mother is a whore.
Everyone knows that.
And your grandmother is...
the mother of a whore. Thank you for reminding me again.
They take hands.
I've been distracted. All is well?
Do Dooley has everything under control, fair seas. I've given the lads some mead. There might be trouble tonight. And there might be some wine in your cabin as well.
I do love you, Jeremy. We shall join the lads on deck as soon as we dine. Don't say anything.
Aye, Captain.
There is a table with dried fish and fruit and wine and candles. It smells of wood and whale tallow.
Dried fish. 4 days in a row. When does Jeremy cook?
Just eat it. You have 10 minutes. Then we shall fuck before we join the lads. Hopefully they will smell it.
I'm not hungry.
They fuck. Then drink wine.
I never knew anything like this.
You are young. Yet, you are older than me.
This feeling has nothing to do with age. I never knew I could be at ease like this. I never knew I wouldn't have to think at every moment to keep things straight. Have you slept with Jeremy?
With Jeremy? What do you think of me? Of course.
Isn't he jealous of us?
Jeremy doesn't care. He has a wife as well, 2 daughters, and 3 sons. He's happy I'm not telling him what to do. Now he can sleep with the lads while I'm distracted. There's not a lot to do on the sea when the weather is calm.
Are you happy?
I am.
So am I. I don't know whether it is better to be a man or a woman.
7 days to Calais. Perhaps I can convince you.
Let's go up.
In the evening, on the boat, we go sailing round the world, with the stars swirl all around us, and the waves beneath the dolphins. In the moonlight, we will sing, till the gods they recognize we. When the wind it blows and the sea it sprays, and the mead begins to flow. We're sailing around the world, how far the sea will take us. Love is the only way out here, or you'll end up in the just to see how far it takes us. We've a cup of mead and a meat indeed, till we find ourselves at
underneath the old oak tree.
I'm bored already.
Oh, shut up. I wasn't speaking to you.
Your mother's a whore.
And your father was a woman.
That doesn't make any sense.
Neither do you.
The bum is perplexed. Ugh. King James is sitting on a bench.
Jimmy.
Jim.
James.
Just call me King.
What are you doing here?
Do you think anyone notices?
You look like Henry V.
I'm sitting here. Is that a crime?
Not anymore, I suppose.
I've been thinking about Archduchess Harriet.
Oh?
They've changed.
Pronouns are going to be the death of me.
They'd like to meet you again.
Oh?
Right now. Hello?
Hello.
You are a woman.
Yes.
I am man.
Yes, I see.
You will come to my palace.
No, 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 I won't.
There are other women there.
Yes, no.
Is it something about me?
No, no, it's me. I have a child.
I have 13.
I have leprosy.
Who doesn't?
The world is round.
Are you a witch?
Yes.
I could have you killed.
Everyone keeps saying that, but it never really happens.
So you and I can't...
No.
Did you finish the poem about the poplar tree?
It's an oak.
I don't know trees.
He chews a piece of straw and stares into the distance for a long time. A smoky speakeasy. Music, voices, and laughter. Marlowe and Orlando are at a table drinking amontillado.
What is this music?
Jazz.
We've never heard anything like it.
It's before your time.
I am a relativist when it comes to time.
We probably shouldn't be here.
They are drunk.
I was thinking that myself.
You never know what might happen.
Underneath the old oak tree.
Jesus Christ.
It's a poem.
It's an affront to humanity.
If it's any consolation, I couldn't understand your last play.
I wouldn't expect so.
It made absolutely no sense.
Well, that's why I wrote it. It's like the critic said when the author asked which was his favorite scene. The last one. Two of the same.
Does my opinion even count?
You must have one more. I told you, it's a celebration. It's a Montiado, for God's sake. We must make it to the dregs.
You're turning 33.
I told you not to say that out loud.
Nobody cares.
I care. It's very disturbing to me. I woke up this morning and I was 33. I don't understand how it could happen. Yesterday, I was 7.5.
Thank you.
It's like an olive with an upside down pimento inside.
What is?
Time, for God's sake. It's a void that wraps around itself with a foldy red thing in the middle. It doesn't have any meaning.
I don't know how old I am, and I really don't care. You're 29. I don't know why it means so much to you.
That's the difference between you and I. You don't care what time of day it is. I imagine I might die every next second, and I need to record it in history.
I can stab you if you want. You could die right now in a speakeasy.
This is lovely. It feels like Mexico.
I need to go back.
A brothel on Bankside in London. Orlando is with three other prostitutes in the parlor. It is late, and they are drinking.
He said he was Alexander Pope.
What?
Alexander Pope.
The Pope.
No, the poet.
He said he was.
Alexander Pope. That he wanted to write me.
What does that even mean? Perhaps he wants to write to you.
Write me. Write me! Put me on paper! And he said he wants to marry me.
Marry you?
That's what he said.
You're already married.
Not technically. Just shut it.
What is it that you like about men?
The smell, the muscle, the skin, also the lips and the tongue. Mostly the smell. I like to hold on to them. They make me feel safe, like my father.
I never knew my father.
You should sleep with more men.
Then you get to know him. They're all the same.
They have different armpits.
What should we do?
We could go make trouble.
It's too late.
Thunder.
There's a storm brewing.
The wind whips.
It's time for bed.
Lightning. A procession like no other. There are peacocks, stilts, unicycles, flowers. It is Queen Victoria. She is dressed in all black and wears a veil. It is a celebration, but there are ominous clouds. The music dissolves into...
It is winter. There is discontent. We are a child.
You are Queen Victoria.
I know how this will end. Albert is dead. I wore black for decades. The Industrial Revolution is upon us. Coal, smoke, arsenic. This is the beginning. What is that thing upon you?
Orlando.
It does not please us.
You may kill it if you like.
We are magnanimous.
The snakes thank you.
They are welcome. Who are you?
Orlando.
Why are you in my way?
I'm sitting here.
We sit rarely.
It is a good state of being.
A storm is coming. People will die. Life will be different. Smokestacks choke the horizon.
Is there anything to be done?
It is beyond our control. The city is wide.
I once had a nanny who told me the world was flat.
It is flat, as a cutting board. Sir Francis Drake fell off the edge. He was in a boat named after a dog. There will always be war. People are dragon breathers.
There is so much.
Too much.
I sometimes worry about our country.
She is strong.
I don't think the people know what they are doing.
The people are vapid. They're plebeians. Everyone dies. That is how the story ends, with certainty. Everyone dies. No one knows what they are doing. They're making it up as we go, and you are a plebeian.
There is no meaning.
Of course there is. The finer things. Home, laughter, children, love, the sea. You cannot appreciate those things, and I despise them.
You are in mourning for your life.
What life?
Well, I should go.
Yes, do. I must wash dishes.
Thank you.
It's so dark. Put this garbage on the street corner.
Orlando is walking home. She twists her ankle. Shell comes to her rescue. He has a French accent.
I'm Marmaduke Bonthrop Shelmerdine, and I may assist you.
Marmaduke.
Yes.
Bonthrop.
Correct.
Shelmerdine.
Marmaduke Bonthrop Shelmerdine.
That's the dumbest name I've ever heard.
Merci. Call me Shell.
Who are your parents?
They're dead. Don't blame them.
I'm sorry.
You didn't kill me, did you?
I don't think so.
Then don't apologize. Is your ankle all right?
There was an uneven stone.
There are uneven stones everywhere.
Marmaduke?
Shell.
Where are you from?
Far away.
Marseille?
Kent. I have a fake accent.
Sometimes I pretend I'm from Poland. I know some people there.
Will you marry me?
What do you do for a living?
Oh, I'm a seaman.
Oh, Jesus.
You don't like seamen?
They smell like the sea when they return.
What's wrong with the sea?
She can't think of an answer. They are married. He goes to sea.
Orlando.
Nick Green, my God.
It's been ages. You've traveled the world.
How did you know?
I slept with your brother.
I don't have a brother.
He said he was your brother.
That was me, before I traveled.
That's right.
You are the most influential literary critic in London.
Well.
You wrote a review last week and the poet killed himself.
That's what writers do. Would you like to fuck?
No, thank you.
I always ask.
It's quite thoughtful.
The one time I didn't.
I'm married.
We can eat.
What do you have?
Balkan things. Peppers and aubergine, bread, pickled carrots.
That would be nice.
Did you bring a plate?
I'm sorry?
I take a plate everywhere. You never know where there will be food.
I didn't know.
I'm pulling your leg.
I thought so.
There is no food.
I finished the poem.
The fig tree.
Oak.
I knew it was a tree.
It has no words.
A poem without words.
It is the snake. He makes excellent letters, but they very rarely spell anything.
He studies Orlando the snake.
It is impressive. Possibly magnificent. I shall publish it with wonderful reviews.
Queen Victoria is dead! Long live King Edward VII!
Suddenly the world is flooded by an unbearable light. It is brighter than it has ever been before. Tatiana drives. She wears aviator sunglasses. Orlando is in the car.
You are an idiot.
This is not new information.
Why would you say yes?
How could I say no?
He's a sailor.
A sailor's what turned me in the first place. There are so many different facets of myself.
Which one do you prefer?
Orlando.
Very funny. Where is he?
In a pillowcase under the seat.
Isn't it noisy for him?
They don't hear. I think he likes the vibrations.
I don't think they're very intelligent.
He's a snake. He has a brain the size of a pea. You think I'm stupid? 2 weeks ago, he tried to eat a stick and I had to pry it out of his mouth. And then he bit me.
Did it hurt?
No. It wouldn't stop bleeding, though. They have an enzyme that prevents coagulation.
When you sailed from Constantinople, what was his name?
Nicholas.
Nick? Nick?
No. There were two of them.
When Shell sails, do you worry that he's sleeping with his crew and every woman he meets at port?
No. I don't think he does. But there's nothing I could do about it anyway. He seems happy when we are together. I'm the one you need to worry about.
I had a lover in Prague. We were inseparable for months. Then came the war.
Why do men fight?
Probably the same reason they fuck.
What day is it today?
Thursday, October 11th, 1928.
Where are we going?
Montauk. What's the matter with you?
I can't stop thinking about time. How fluid it is.
You are obsessed with time. And death.
Bury the boy. The boy is dead. Must bury the boy.
Under the oak tree?
You always know where to cut.
I'm the Queen of England.
Which one?
Victoria.
You're not in mourning.
Albert is alive.
What is that?
An aeroplane. An automobile that flies. Lindbergh will fly one across the ocean before his son dies.
I always wanted a son.
In jazz, the depression, the war.
We just had the war.
The next one, it's worse.
How can it be worse than the Great War?
You're right. It's better.
They drive into the ocean. End of play. The lights come up to half. It is dusk. The actors thank the audience personally. There is no applause. The sound of frogs and crickets, then water and mosquitoes. Orlando.
Thank you, everybody. My name is T. I am special visiting faculty in dramaturgy at the School of Drama. And before we begin, I want everyone to introduce themselves. Damon, I'm going to start with you, and then we'll just go down the line if you don't mind.
My name's Damen Scranton. I'm from Pasadena, California. I lived on the East Coast doing theater at companies. I taught at Carnegie Mellon for 8 weeks, so it feels like home. And me and Ivan go way back. It's a pleasure to be here.
Excellent. Thank you. Thank you, Ivan.
Well, I introduced myself at the beginning, Ivan Talijancic. I'm on faculty at the John Wells Directing Program at CMU, and I directed Damon's play. Yay!
Hi, my name is Priya, and I assistant directed.
Hello, my name is Edward Patrick, and I was an actor.
Yay! Hi, everyone. I'm Lilac. I played Orlando. Hi, I'm Jasmine, and I was an actor.
Hi, Spencer, actor.
Hi, I'm B, and I was an actor.
Hello, Colton, media specialist.
Excellent. My first question is going to be for you, Damon. What about the novel Orlando drew you to adapt it into a play?
I'm telling you, I read it at UCSD as part of like a gender studies literature class, and I really loved it, but then I just put it to the side. And it's all about this damn snake. And I'll show you guys the snake at the end, but she takes up too much space. So I got a snake and I decided to name it, them, Orlando, which made me want to go back and read the book. And it just really resonated with me as a member of the LGBTQ community and a lot of this stuff that's going on right now. It feels like a book that was way before its time. And I love literature and I love metaphor in literature. So there's too many things about the book that I love to talk about.
Yes, thank you. I read online that Ivan talked you into this. This was just a first draft that you didn't necessarily expect to go anywhere. Ivan, what about this draft made you say, hey, there's something in here that we can do right now in like an experimental sort of way?
So as Damon mentioned, he and I, we go way, way back. We were at undergrad together at UC San Diego. And continued to collaborate throughout the years and whatnot. So Damon just sent me the play. I don't think there was any intention to work on it. He was just like, hey, I want you to read this. It's funny. I I read it and I was like, oh, wow, this is really cool. But I didn't have this, immediate reaction to work on it. But then the same week, the sophomore actors were doing their scenes in class. And I saw Lilac and Spencer do a scene. And I was like, well, Spencer is one of my students, so I see him every week. I knew he was good, but I didn't know that he was such a good performer. And Lilac was like a revelation to me. So I saw them perform and I was like, well, this is Orlando. And we should just try to put this together. So that's how it all started.
Fantastic. I wonder about how you landed on the form of the single shot rotating camera. Especially because, normally single shot things take weeks to orchestrate, and the fact that this was put together in 2 days, which is amazing that this was put together in 2 days. I wonder how you landed on the form of this is how we're going to present it.
I am not really sure. It was one of the Priya, who I'm going to pass the mic to in a second, is going to have a much smarter response to that. And I'm not going to take any credit for it. But it was also funny that it kind of happened simultaneously. When I started thinking about how to put it together, I knew that I didn't want it to be like a reading with, you know, microphone stands. So, you know, I landed on this idea of just like recording the audio first and then staging it to a soundtrack. And there's like something in the play that's about the relentless march of time, you know, and we go through like what, like 5 centuries, I think, as the play goes in 40 minutes. So, you know, this notion of a like the endless procession, you know, that just kind of keeps going and going and going and going and never stops, I think is sort of like, and where things just kind of like come in and out. But what Priya has to say, which I, again, had no idea about this, it just coincidentally happens to be super relevant. The thing about Laura Mulvey.
Yes. So Laura Mulvey is very awesome. And this connects actually to what we're talking about. Laura Mulvey, in her article, Visual Art and Narrative Cinema, she's the one who coined the term the male gaze that we all know. That we all know so well now. But anyway, she coined the term the male gaze. She was this film theorist, thought a lot about feminism, thought a lot about film. And then her first film was called, I believe, The Mystery of the Sphinx. And it was shot in a similar manner. It was shot entirely at waist level, panning 360 degrees continually. And the idea behind doing this was to find a cinematic language that wasn't that was entirely impassive, that wasn't informed by gender or by power or by trying to manipulate the viewer, but just trying to show something as objectively as possible. And it's a movie I haven't watched because, if you can believe it, it's incredibly boring and really bad. I respect her for trying, but in execution, you know, really, it's not good at all. But as an idea, it's pretty interesting. I think Orlando turned out better than that.
Oh, thank you. I had no idea. It was, I think we were in the midst of doing it, or like when I explained the concept to you, you were like, did you know this? I had no idea. Coincidences.
I didn't know it was so bad.
Damon, I have one more question for you before I have some questions for the ensemble. The play manifesting in this way, what have you learned about the play from it being filmed in this way and performed in this way? Is there any revelation that you're taking away from this? Anything like that?
Well, I just wrote in the chat and I can't multitask because I'm a man. But I think that something about Ivan's work at Wax Factory, I was talking about this with he and Erica, one of his compatriots, and it goes to a Suzuki thing. There's something in Suzuki movement method called stomping and shakuhachi. And shakuhachi is just this slow procession forward. It's like you just slowly approach the audience until you're standing right in front of them. And then you stop. And there's something about Wax Factory's work that always feels like that to me. And I felt that so much in the filming of it. Like I kind of feel like I need to keep turning right now very slowly. And it really made me think about that in terms of the play, because it is just this, there's no kind of going back with this play. It's just kind of moving forward. It jumps back and forth in time, but it just moves through the narrative and also the music, how important. I loved the additional scoring stuff that Ivan put in there. I have a lot to think about right now.
That's always great. I'm going to pass it on to Lilac. I would love to know what it was like being Orlando and being on camera for 40 minutes straight in this one shot sort of scenario that y'all had.
It was a super interesting process. It happened really quickly, and we ran it once and then we did a one take of it. And but it was such a wonderful thing to be a part of. And Orlando as a character, I just see as someone who's very go with the flow, and it's interesting that we follow his story through, or sorry, excuse me, their story and the way their gender changes and the way that their story is just, they go with it. They go with whatever is in front of them. And by that, they create these, I don't know, amazing conversations. And it was just a very interesting thing to be a part of. I've never been on camera for 40 minutes straight. And having to like move with the camera was its own challenge, and making sure that we were in frame was also a big part of it. But mostly just loving the character of Orlando and loving how easy they were, how just mellow and interesting. I don't know. There's so many things. And it's also crazy to see, because this, we did this 5 months ago. So it's been really a jump, and watching it for the first time, there were so many things that came back and we were like, oh yes, Shell. It was a lot of fun.
I want to open this up to anyone watching it again after being away from it for 5 months. Was there anything that like an experience in creating it that like your memory was jogged of, something that you're like, oh yes, I remember this thing happening, or this part of the process was really rewarding for me that I might have forgotten about? Yes, B.
It was super exciting to see how slow it felt. In the moment of doing it, you are running around and changing costumes and trying to remember where you are and trying to avoid the camera, and it was utter chaos. And the way that something so smooth came out of that chaos was really exciting and really feels like such the form and the performance of it is such a metaphor for the thing itself.
Oh yeah, I was just talking to Senior Director Moses today, kind of about, they just went and saw a Greek sing on campus, where all of the fraternities and sororities perform little snippets of musicals. And Moses said, well, objectively, it was bad. But at the same time, they were having far more fun making theater than a lot of stuff that we have to do in School of Drama. And so it was overall a really, in those 2 days, a really joyous experience as well, and something that was just purely fun. I mean, I don't know, very, very stress-free, especially with recording the dialogue. I just felt like I got to go up there, make some silly faces and gesture and then act drunk. And that was just that's what came back to me. And it was remembering the fun that we had making it.
For me, it was very fun, but this was my first time ever being on camera for anything. So I was like kind of stressing out a little bit. Like I remember in like the 4 days, like when I got the script, like the week before I got the script, I thought that we had to be memorized. I didn't know that we were gonna, you know, come in and record on little microphones and then put the audio over. So I'm like in my dorm room on YouTube, how to do a Russian accent, how to do a Royal English accent. And I'm over here and I'm like, oh no, Orlando.
She's upstaging you. I'm so sorry. I told you she's very distracting. Never act with animals or babies. That's the lesson.
I would absolutely do a scene with her.
Yeah.
At the drop of a hat.
Oh, she's super chill. But as an actor, I've been on stage with her, actually, at Sledge, no, my old snake, 25 years ago in San Diego, was on stage in a Naomi Izuka play at Sledgehammer Theater. And it's amazing because all of a sudden, all your focus goes to the snake instead of all the bullshit that's usually in your head as an actor. So you just kind of have to tap into like, I'm doing what I'm doing, but really I just need to watch out for the snake. So sorry for the interruption, continue.
Right, so I was on YouTube and I was looking all these things up. I remember like the first day that we got there to the warehouse and started recording everything, I was like, wait a minute, like I'm literally doing this voluntarily. Like, let's just have fun with it. And so then once I kind of got in that mindset, I was like, this is actually really enjoyable. Yeah, but it was a nice little experience.
The lighting looked really good. Yeah, I couldn't, you can't see it because there was just the camera inside. So I was seeing it from the outside and I was like, oh, you can't see anyone's face. Yeah, you can't because the light was on the other side of their faces. What?
Blinded the whole time.
Blind the whole time.
Well, what I remember is, you know, on paper, it all looked so much easier than it actually was. And so what I remember from when we started working, we did the recording first, of course, because that had to be, you know, edited together in order for us to perform to it. But the whole process for me was just like one massive letting go. I was like, Ivan, just don't direct, just let them do it. Just let them do it. And yeah, so then it was fun because I was like, okay, well, here we go. There was no, like, there was really kind of no rehearsal. It was just like, okay, go. Right.
Yeah.
We sort of, I mean, sketched it out, but there was something really liberating about it, just to kind of like, it was like, well, let's see what happens.
It was very interesting. Oh, I can say this into a microphone too. It was interesting. I had to do the opposite of what all your directing training tells you to do, which is sit in a corner and yell at people to move to places. My whole life, people said, don't do that. And then I got to do it for 45 minutes and I loved it.
Same here. I tend to work in a very collaborative way, but here there was just like no time. So I basically had to be like, go there. And now you enter and now you exit and now you hug her and then you go. And it felt really weird, but it just had to be done or else there would have been no play.
Like, looking at that, adding on to what B was saying, just like, it was such a crazy, it was a whirlwind of a weekend. It went so fast. And I remember we had like, what, like 4 hours on both days, like super tight, super quick. And just hearing all the voiceovers, like all the accents, there was so much going on. And like Spence was saying, it was just such a reminder. Like, we had so much fun, and it just that was the best feeling to get from watching this, like how much fun we all had together. It was a really great experience to be a part of. So thank you, Yvonne. Thank you, Damon. Thank you, everyone.
Yeah, so we do want to be aware of everyone's time this evening. So are there any questions from the audience about the experience, about
Zoom too?
Zoom as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. Does Orlando have any questions, any thoughts? Anything in the Zoom chat? Not currently? All right. With that, any Damon, any final thoughts that you want to leave with the room on what I think is a spectacular adaptation of a very difficult novel to adapt? Any thoughts?
Just thank you to everybody. It was great. I don't know whether to like go back and work on it more or just let it go. So I'm gonna have to think about that. But thank you so much. And it was so creative and inventive, and all you all, seriously, I've been there and done it, and I wrote it in 2 days and you guys put it together in 2 days, and I know what that chaos was. So remember that moment. It was you did awesome work. Just thank you from my heart. And Orlando says thank you too.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you so much, Damon. Yvonne, any last words you want to leave with anybody?
Yeah, thank you everybody for like jumping into this like crazy thing. It was so much fun. And I mean, Damon, for, you know, like birthing it and sharing it with us. It was, that's where it all started. So thank you so much. We should do it. We should do it for real.
And thank you to the
To the snake.
Thank you to the snake is what I said.
Oh, you're welcome. I loved the snake movement, by the way. Like, it really started subtle, but then when it really got incorporated into the dance as part of that, like, I thought that worked just brilliantly, actually. So now I need to rethink whether it needs to be a real snake or not.
I was just going to say, I always saw Orlando and the snake as like one entity. So
yeah.
The way that like the, it just came from like Orlando, the person, I guess. And Orlando, it's all just you. I mean, you know, it's all one. And I'm glad that that came across. Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you everybody for coming out this evening. We're going to wrap up here. Damon, thank you so much. Cast and crew, thank you so much. And we will talk to you later.
Oh, one more thanks that I forgot to mention earlier. Karen Cellini joining us from Massachusetts on Zoom. Thank you so much. Karen Cellini was that beautiful smoky voice who narrated the whole thing. Love you. And thank you for being here.